All right, we're gonna do this part two. I had some issues with my internet. And we're gonna get Jason up here. We're gonna try this again. Better, we got it.
Where I'm at. Okay guys, we're good to go.
Woohoo! We made it, we made it, we made it, made it, made it. Okay.
Okay, cool.
Hi. Hi everyone, welcome, welcome back. I'm happy to be here with everyone.
I'm excited.
I'm happy to be here with you.
Thank you. You know, for everybody that doesn't know, this is an extension of the FaceTime that Laura and I were having before this show.
Yep.
We were just kind of going to veer into whatever we were talking about.
Yeah. But
in regards to, I think, why we came here, and we'll definitely dabble on that as well, we can start with the idea of proof, right? And what is it? I know I've been getting a lot of questions of where's the proof, where's the pictures, what's going on?
Well, I think the reason you and I even wanted to do this sort of topic in the first place at least for myself, the topic that our intention sort of for this live, although it's going to go all over the place, our intention was to talk about proof and why does something become proof? How do you know it's proof? Some people's proof isn't somebody else's proof. And the reason I find this to be an important topic right now is because there's so much unraveling for us. There's so much that we are starting to discover, explore, learn, things that have been hidden, things that have been behind the scenes, things that are really challenging for us to hold and believe and understand. And so I think it's an important topic to just look at and explore. If anything, it brings awareness to what we do as humans, which is, well, you have to show me proof. You have to show me the evidence. You have to show me proof in order for me to believe it. And even if you show me proof, I might not believe it, right?
Why do you think that happens, though? Why do you think, where is the question show me proof coming from? Because I think what I always try to do is kind of break it down to where is the foundation? Because if we could fix it from the foundation, then we can change our resonance pretty quickly. So we're focusing on where is the proof. Why are we asking that question in the first place?
I think because this is what I would say. I think as humans, we are programmed to need physical evidence to be able to say, okay, this is real. And what I find fascinating is even if you have physical evidence, people still don't believe it. So why do you need physical evidence? Because you need to see it. We need to see it. We're programmed to believe that.
For sure. So yeah, I definitely think it starts with the fact that we've been indoctrinated to certain beliefs. And back to what we were saying before in our FaceTime, I think, this is just my opinion, and go with it, you don't have to, it's all good. But my belief of at least part of where this all starts is, it's apparent in history. First, I'll ask a question. We know that there are illusionists, magicians, that levitate in front of 10,000 people on stages in Las Vegas. And we know that David Blaine or David Copperfield, whoever he was, made the Statue of Liberty disappear in front of New York City's eyes. And we also know that those were illusions. So what do you actually have to see? Where is the line of proof? Where is the line where there's an indefinite, that is real? Why can't, if I see a man levitating in front of me, if I see a man flying, if I see a human being shapeshift from a human being to a dog, who's to say that somebody didn't put some drugs in my water and make me hallucinate? Who's to say that that's just an illusion, just like all the illusionists do on the stage, right? On the stage in Las Vegas. And I don't think that's a very efficient way to determine if something is real or not, and if that's proof or not, because there is no indefinite way to say this is real and this isn't. So back to what we were saying, I think it starts from the root of, I would say, suppression. And over time, you know this probably better than anybody I know, Lori, we as human beings are spiritual beings, we're energetic beings, and we're powerful beings. And time and time and time again in history, we've been either shamed or ridiculed or executed for practicing certain things that allow us to realize our power. So lefties, left-handed individuals, used to be called servants of the devil. Now we know that left-handed individuals are right brain dominant. And right brain dominant is where a lot of the access and keys to spiritual abilities and what we call supernatural abilities exist. Then you go to witchcraft. Even today, we're still indoctrinated to think that a witch is evil, and that's not true. Witchcraft is the manipulation of energy. And by the way, so is levitation. Levitation is the knowledge of the manipulation of energy. So I think that the reason why people are asking for proof today is because we've been thrown so deep into this hole of suppressed knowledge. We don't have the true knowledge that really teaches us who we are. And therefore, we're asking questions that don't have definitive answers. Even if I were to bring an alien in front of you, you could tell me Hollywood makeup. You know, so where is that line?
Well, it's interesting, like, as you're talking, I'm this is what we were saying earlier before we came on live, but when we are birthed into this reality, right, we're birthed into this matrix, we're birthed into this dimensional field. From that moment, we are kind of doomed in terms of proof and truth, because, you know, it's all given to us. It's all provided to us. We're told it, right? And so this is the scientific, you know, you go to school and you're like, oh, the scientific method is dot, dot, dot. You know, you have a hypothesis and then you do this and then you have a study. And then we are programmed to hold a belief system in terms of what becomes truth or proof for us. And I think what we're doing now, a lot of us that are awakening out of this slumber and out of this matrix and field, is that we are starting to move back into our natural, like we were talking earlier, our natural state of being, which is energy first, right? And when you move into that state, when you if you were to watch somebody, like let's say you could all of a sudden levitate, right? I wouldn't say to you, oh no, I need physical proof, because I would have pulled myself already out of that third dimensional matrix and I would understand energy. So I wouldn't even be thinking in terms of that matrix that I've been programmed to believe is the only way that I'm going to receive proof, right? We start to learn to pull from the shelves new ways of being, including new ways of understanding truth and proof, and beginning to ask yourself, what lens, what matrix lens am I using to decide whether this is proof or truth for me or not? And is it from a higher state of consciousness and awareness, or is it from the programmed, this is what I'm told to do, told to be, told to receive, right? Because like we were saying earlier, I mean, this programming that we've been in, it's insanity. Like, it's crazy.
Crazy indoctrination process. It's real. You know, when you step out from it, when you step away from it, I wouldn't say that, I mean, eventually I'm sure we'll be able to see it clearly, but we're in the process of only beginning to see what's going on here. And just as we thought we saw it all, something else comes. It keeps going like that. But you said it perfectly. We're being indoctrinated. Our beliefs are not ours. They're beliefs that were imposed upon us. And listen, the brainwashing is crazy. The brainwashing is unbelievable. But you brought up the point of energy, which is, it's like, I mean, it's the basis of everything. It's the basis of the universe. So When you said the scientific method, I was just writing about that actually, and I don't really know where it came from, but it completely connects to what you're saying. And my question was, what considers something to be alive or not alive? And is there actually such thing as something not being alive? So the question is, okay, well, what's life? So I said, one second, before I try and answer that, let me see what science says. And I looked at the criteria for what life, what is needed to constitute something as being alive. And it was something like genetic material, ability to replicate, things like that. Now, when I saw it, what I saw was that method of a criteria to decide what's alive and what's not is a direct reflection of our collective level of awareness. Because if you were to go deeper, Nikola Tesla said something that I also kind of put into what I was writing. And it was something along the lines of, the second science decides to focus on non-physical phenomena, they will progress more in the next decade than they did in the existence of humanity. And why that's so important is because of what you just said. Everything is energy. So what's life? What is the common denominator between that criteria that science calls life? And the common denominator is whether you're breathing, whether you have blood, whether you're a tree, whether you're a stone, whether you're anything that's tangible or intangible, the common denominator is some form of energy, some source energy. And the common denominator of that energy, who, by the way, was brought forth by a man named Nassim Haramein, who I completely admire. He's an incredible physicist that I think is the Einstein of our time, but people have been putting him down just like they put Einstein so far. But he proved that energy is actually consciousness. And if consciousness is what connects us all, and when I say us all, it's not just humans, but it's everything, well, then a rock is no less alive than we are. And we're no more alive than a rock is, because ultimately when we break it down to what you said, to that energetic truth, to that fundamental reality, we're all one and the same. And it's like, when anybody says, well, a rock is dead, it's just dead, it's not alive. How does it have, it doesn't have awareness. No, that's not true. It's just, we collectively, some people can, but collectively, we're not at the level of awareness to perceive the consciousness that a rock has.
Right.
And therefore, our world today and the limitations and beliefs that we set, they're just, I mean, I see that they're a reflection of the limitations that we have in our awareness. And as that range increases and gets bigger, so will what we're able to see.
As you're talking, I'm getting this vision. I love how my guides give me these visions, but there's like building blocks, right? Or like you step on a block, right? And you're raised a level. You step on another block, you're raised another level. And as you raise, you can see more, right? Your vantage point expands. There's more that you start seeing. So when you're on the ground, third dimension, physical science, that's the only thing that exists, so supposedly, right? Your vision, your field of vision and what you can see is so limited, right? Then you jump up onto this next level of awareness and you're like, holy freak, there's so much more, right? And then you jump onto that next block and you're so much higher. It's always been there. All of this has always been there, right? It's just the level of awareness and where you're standing. And I always like to call this like stepping out of the freaking matrix. And what level of, where are you standing? What level are you standing on when you are trying to decipher and pull in your truth? Think about it. You got to start asking yourself that question. Am I using the first level of block, the third dimensional physical scientific proof? Mm-hmm. Or am I starting to use blocks that raise me higher so that I can see more of what is actually real?
For sure.
But hasn't been programmed into me, because this is the human journey and the human experience, and we're programmed and suffocated with dense consciousness right now.
Shurka said it's like the difference of standing on a third floor of a building and looking out the window, or on the 100th floor of a building and looking out the window. Where are you going to see more? You know, when we're on the third floor of a building looking out the window, how far can you really see? And the illusion is that the horizon is our limitation on the third floor. But when we get to that top of the building, suddenly we're like, whoa, there's a whole world here. And it's huge. And it's bigger than I thought it could be. And you zoom out, and you zoom out, and it only gets bigger and bigger. I don't think there's a limit to that. I think it keeps getting bigger. The incomprehensible measure, our level of awareness right now.
Well, and think of how much more open you become to realities that you just haven't yet explored or seen yet. Instead of being so pigeonholed in, oh no, this is the only truth, this is the only reality, it's gotta be this way, right? Think of what happens when you start to raise your consciousness, raise your awareness, raise your level of seeing things. You start to say, oh, wait, maybe there are aliens. Why would there not be? Just because I can't physically see them? Wait, maybe people can levitate. Why am I not believing that? Just because I can't physically understand it, right? We start to open ourselves and allow ourselves to embrace, step out of the freaking programming of all of this. And you know, and I want to bring it back really quickly, because I think this is important. I want to bring it back to when people have cognitive dissonance, okay? And I think it's important, because one of the things that I really want to use this live for is to ask people, what level of awareness are you at? Why are you at that level of awareness? Are you choosing to move into a higher level of awareness? And what is stopping a human from not moving into that higher level of awareness?
I think I'm saying the same thing, just in different words. Why does somebody choose to believe or to not believe? It goes exactly back. This is a big topic. The cognitive dissonance thing is huge. We spoke about this also. I think it stems from the fact, and it's something that I think we all do, and we got to be aware of so we can put a stop to it, but we make our beliefs a part of us. So let's say I believe aliens are not real. They're fantasy. They're Hollywood. And you, Lori, come and say, listen, aliens are real. And I've seen one. Okay? Well, what would make me choose either to believe your experience or to not believe your experience? And if my foundation and my foundational belief that's part of me is aliens are not real, if that belief is a part of me, when you tell me that they are, what I would really have to do to believe you is crumble my foundation of beliefs, my belief system. So beliefs are fine. I think beliefs are great. I mean, they're awesome, you know, but they change. And we're entitled to change our beliefs. I think the problem arises when people make their beliefs part of themselves. Because suddenly when you attack the belief, that person feels like you're attacking them. And that's, so far throughout my thought process of this, I think that's a very foundational part of the issue that we're seeing today. And it's not just today. We've seen it with Einstein, right? Einstein in 1905 or whatever it was, some 20-year-old kid came out and said, hey, guys, time is relative. It's not absolute. But for 264 years before that, everybody went along to Newton's laws of time, where time is absolute. So when this kid that comes out of nowhere, named Albert Einstein, came out and said, you guys, this is wrong, and this is why it's wrong. His teachers were kicking him out of class. They wanted him to expel him from school. Nobody wanted to go with what he was saying, even though the proof was in front of their eyes. It was. He had his theory of relativity shown with formulas and everything. And now it's accepted, but the reason why I think it took so long to accept was because, and I'll ask you a question, story. Let's say you were a teacher, a physicist, that spent her entire life teaching thousands upon thousands upon thousands of students. That time is not relative. That time is actually absolute. And I came to you and I said, hey, time is relative. What I'm really telling you is everything that you did up until now, throughout your entire life, everything that you've made money off of in your career, everything that you've taught your students in university and school is wrong. And if you're in a place where your belief system became a part of you, you feel that I'm attacking you. And I get it. It makes sense. But just imagine how much further we would have been today if that resistance to Einstein wasn't there. If the greatest minds in the world, instead of resisted him, said, wait, this guy has a point. Forget that he's 20. Forget that he's new. He has a point here. And it's here. So let's run with it and see what happens. And we finally started getting there. That took us into quantum physics and everywhere else that we're in that I don't understand. But imagine we accepted that reality in 1904. You understand how much further we would have been today if we didn't resist things because we felt that it attacked our foundation. So that's the cognitive. We have to stop our beliefs part of us.
Right, which is attachment. So, you know, it's the same thing when you attach to your emotions. When you attach to something, it's going to weigh you down, right? And it's a very normal thing we do in the human journey, in the human experience. We label ourselves based on our experiences, based on our past, and we create who we are and our reality based on emotions, thoughts, beliefs, behaviors, programs and paradigms, right? It builds who we are. And when you move into these higher states of consciousness and awareness, which is what we're doing right now, you literally have to let go of everything. You have to let go of everything. And one of the things that you have to let go of, that especially in this now moment that we're navigating, is our beliefs around everything and anything. Because when you let go, when you stop attaching, you can still have the belief. But you start to open yourself up to all these other possible beliefs that may be out there as well. And you're not saying that's right and that's a wrong belief. I'm the right belief, you're the wrong belief. What you're saying is, holy shit, I'm in a quantum field. I'm in a quantum field right now where there are so many other possible beliefs, truths, ways of being that I can or cannot perhaps see right now. But what am I doing in my now? Am I weighing myself down? And that's okay if you are. Just ask yourself that question. Why am I weighing myself down? Well, like you said, it's who I am. I'm attached to this. I've built my whole life on this. It's scary. When we recognize that in another person, we no longer belittle them or judge them or name call, right? You're like, oh, I understand why that person doesn't want to let go of their belief. I get it now, right? We're starting to really dissect and pull apart what's actually happening here. Because that is a part of cognitive dissonance. You know, the other part of cognitive dissonance is that's too crazy. What the hell? Whatever you just said is so nuts that even if you show it to me and give me an actual physical video or picture, you know, there's no way that my consciousness can hold that. I will lose my mind, right? And so being able to understand that as well, this is going to allow the awakened ones to continue to move up these levels, right? And let the human that isn't quite ready yet to slowly open their eyes and, like, you know, get the little, like, stuff out of the eyes when you wake up, whatever that's called, and wake up. But the other, one more thing, the piece that's really important here is for not only us to dissect and to really observe our awareness around our attachment to beliefs and how, what lens we are using, but also the other human. When you start watching how the other human is being and you stop freaking name calling, belittling, pointing your finger, right? And you start to observe if and when you do that, we will be able to move the human collective much faster.
Have you ever looked, I don't know.
Sleepies. Yeah, sleepies. That's what it's called. What?
Have you ever looked at your not identified it as a man, but looked at it for what it is?
No.
You know what I'm talking? Okay, so maybe that's just me because I'm weird.
Wait, but so what do you do?
What I do. When I try and one of my practices of disidentifying with something, to look at it not for what I've been taught to see it as, but for what it actually is. So, for example, there's sometimes where I look at my head and I'm in awe. And it's like what it, forget the fact that it's a hand with five fingers and fingernails and all that. What the hell is this thing? It's something that I can move without moving it. I'm doing something in my brain to make it move.
All right.
That sometimes water comes out of it that we sweat.
Right.
Like this feeling of whatever is, and nails have a different type. It's like, what am I looking at? Take a bird, right? When an infant looks at a bird, they look at it like, what the hell is that? But over time, when their parents say, that's a bird, then they're just like, oh, when they see the bird again, they're like, that's a bird. And it's a bird, and that's all it is. But when you lose the identification of that's a bird, or that's Lori, and I do this with people a lot, when I start getting frustrated by somebody's actions or remarks, or I just want to observe somebody, I look at their face without giving them a name. And I don't look at their entire face. I just look at the position of their eyes and their nose and how their mouth moves. And it's really weird for me when I do that, because it's like, what am I looking at? But it's this liberating feeling for me, because there's no more identification of that's my uncle or that's my father or that's my sister. It's, you are what you are, and you're just this being that's being. And when I see that, I just kind of, the beliefs aren't that kind of relevant to me so much anymore. Same thing with stars. When something's bothering me, if I'm in a bad mood and I want to put things into proportion, I just look up at night.
That's, yeah, just like that. It shifts you. It shifts you like that.
But it's like, I'm huge. This is small. This is nothing. But back to what you said about the whole beliefs and attachment, I think, wait, can everybody hear me? No, people are saying they can't hear me. Should I try Wi-Fi?
You're fine. It's better when you're closer to the phone.
It says it's breaking up. I have no idea.
Oh, your audio is choppy, I think. But it's a little bit like, it's a little choppy. It's a little like, spotty, I guess, you know, coming in and out. Some people can hear you.
Okay. I'll finish what I was saying and then I'll move while you're talking so we don't break it up. But in regards to what you were saying about attachment, I think when you're attached to something and I attack that belief, it feels like it's like what we said, right? If I shoot you, it's like, if I shoot you in the arm, what are you going to do? You're going to fight me back because I just shot you in the arm. But if I just shot this water bottle that isn't a part of you, and I just shot a water bottle. However, if this water bottle meant something to you, your great-grandmother who passed away gave this water bottle to you, and it's sentimental to you, and I shot the water bottle, again, you're going to fight me because it's been a part of you. It's a part of your being. So right. I think reality is just a whole lot more beautiful when you detach from those beliefs and just have them instead of be them.
I think it's huge what you're saying, because basically it's being the observer. I mean, as soon as you become the observer in every now moment, which is a constant practice, and with observing, it's like, oh, I'm the observer. And it seems like a really simple thing to do, right? Sort of also like present moment, like, oh yeah, I can do present moment. I can be the observer. And it's like, no, 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 you don't understand what that means to be the observer, right? Because literally, and you do know what it means to be the observer, but when you are the observer, it's like you're literally watching yourself be you, right? So you're watching every response, every reaction. It's like you're looking at your hand separate from you, right? So you're oh my God, I'm now holding this belief. Oh my God, I'm now doing this to this person. Oh my God. And when you're in that state of awareness, you are not attached. And when you are not attached, if somebody comes to me with a belief and I'm thinking to myself, my instant knee-jerk reaction is, nope. All, as the observer that I practice 24/7 or every now moment, right? I'll be like, oh, look at that knee-jerk reaction. I immediately said no to that person's belief.
For sure.
Why did I do that, right? So if you're observing, you will automatically recognize the knee-jerk hell no, right? Then yeah. As the observer, you say, okay, why did I go right there? What is it that they're saying to me? Where is my resonance? Is this an energetic resonance that's no, right? Or is it a old systemed program that's been given to me from the age of 3 that's telling me no, right? And I think this ability to kind of see the bigger picture, go outside and look at the stars, right? Stare at your hand and see it from as not your hand, but as this amazing thing. That gives you the observer perspective. You literally pull yourself out of being or labeling yourself Lori. I am Lori. No, I'm not Lori. I'm actually not Lori, right? I am playing the role of Lori. You're not Jason. You're playing the role of Jason as a human in a third dimensional body, in a third dimensional consciousness, trying to navigate what the freak are we doing here and how do I step out of this third dimensional platform that suffocates me? And observing is like the first huge step in recognizing everything.
For sure. And I always ask myself when somebody brings something forth to me that may not be a part of what I currently hold or believe, sometimes I react, right? Sometimes I'm like, wait, no way. And then, because that's just, I think, where I'm at currently, sometimes I do that. I try not to. But what I always do is, whether I react or respond, if I do react, I always take a step back after and I'm like, why did I do that? Where did it come from? And what can I do about it? How can I fix it? How can I change it? Why don't I want to believe certain things that people are bringing to me? And when it comes to proof, I think it's just a really important thing to hold, because nobody's going to bring something that's indefinite. And when it comes to raising your awareness, raising your consciousness, raising your vibration, just like you said with the building, right? When you're on a higher level, when you're on a higher floor, you see things that you might have not been able to see beforehand. So I'll bring it apart from the pyramid code, that document that really holds this insight through something that's going on in the world today. Astrologically, we know of like the 12 houses, the 12 zodiac signs in the zodiac. And we know those constellations, the crab and the lion, and I don't know, I'm not an expert.
I don't know them very well, but whatever. I don't even know what the crab is or the lion. Did you say crab and lobster?
No, crab and lion.
Oh, I thought you said lobster.
I know the crab. My birthday's in June.
I don't even know what I am. What's Aquarius? The water bearer, I think. Okay, anyways, go on. Sorry.
We're both water signs. Okay. But within the constellations, they're, according to the document, and I can't prove this because I can't see it, but it says that there are 12 stars within each of the 12 houses, within each of the 12 zodiac signs that we cannot see, which means that there are 144 stars within the zodiac that are not visible to the naked eye. Why? Because they exist in fifth dimensional awareness. That means that if you or I or anybody else are at fifth dimensional awareness, we'd be able to see it. But so long as, let's say, we're operating through 3D, you could bring the craziest, most expensive telescope you want. You will not see it because it's not in your range of perception. And that's like the fundamental energetic law and reality of the universe. There could be a being standing in front of me. And
there is all the time.
And we can't perceive it because that being exists out of our range of perception. So that's with proof. You increase your range of perception, you'll see things that you couldn't see before.
And that's also why we would literally, like, we want to be able to see what's actually around us, right? We're like, oh, no, I want to see it. I want to see it. And my guides are always like, no, you guys aren't ready yet, because you would literally lose your mother freaking minds if you actually saw everything that was in the sky, everything that was around you. You would literally, like, have a psychotic break because you wouldn't be able to, you couldn't funnel it into your really slow mind. You wouldn't be able to process it. Like, there are thousands upon thousands of craft in the sky right now that we can't see because we're not vibrating at that frequency yet, right? You look around in your room, there's all kinds of things hanging out with us, but we can't see it yet because our bodies aren't vibrating at that frequency. And that's, and many scientists would say, prove that. So then you go, you're in that third dimensional first block, right? You're standing on that first block. Cool. I'm standing on block number 5. I'll see you when you get here.
Science proves that. And I'm not sure how they don't see it, because what you just said in terms of just the law, the reality of you see what you're in resonance with, it's a fact. It's not an opinion. It's a fact that science proves. So again, I think the limitation when it comes to science is the fact that it's only willing to study what it's in resonance with, but physical phenomena. So can we talk about what you brought up, something I want to talk about it. Can we talk about the aspect of being ready?
Yeah, what does that mean? What do you mean being ready? Oh, being ready to, yeah, absolutely, yeah. Like being ready to see it all.
Being ready, you know, people have this like idea of, what do you mean I'm not ready? You saying I'm not good enough? No.
Yeah.
I'm not ready for a lot of things. You're not ready for a lot of things. It's just important to like understand that not being ready is not a bad thing. I remember when I was growing up, and I wrote about this a long time ago in my journal, because this is something that how I would like to raise them. Whenever I wanted to do something or I wanted to whatever, my parents never told me you're not old enough. They never said you're not old enough. They never said when you're older. They said you're not ready or when you're ready. And the difference is that it's not about your age. It has nothing. You could be 60 and not ready. You could be 15 and ready for something. It has nothing to do with how old you are. It's what are you ready to receive? That's the most important thing. Because for me, growing up, I never felt like, because if they told me when you're 20 years old, if I had to do something and they said when you're 20, then I just would have waited until I was 20.
Right.
I would have done it. But right. I wouldn't have done anything to prepare for it. But because they said when you're ready, it was, now there's an initiative that I have to take in order to increase something, in order to learn something, in order to evolve in one way or another, to be ready. So a lot of people, especially when it came to things like the pyramid code with the whole code and why aren't we getting it and whatever it is, I don't have it either, guys. And it's truthfully, I don't want it because I don't think we're ready. First of all, I'm definitely not ready to receive something. I don't know what it consists of because I don't have it, but just looking at the world again, and I said this in the past, that code was taken away from humanity because humanity abused it. And if you look around yourself, we're still living in a time where humanity, we're waking up, we're progressing in a good direction, but there are still many people in power, many respected authorities that abuse their power. And if something of that power was put into the wrong hands, it can do a lot of damage. And I think being ready is not just, there's like the individual level of being ready, and there's the collective level of being ready. And I think that's what kind of differentiates the fact that my path may be different from yours, but our path together is together. So there's like the individual destiny and the collective destiny, and the individual destiny can be, what are you ready for on the individual level? And you may be able to have certain dreams or see things or have certain experiences and so on. But the collective level, when it comes to a code, there are people that have that code. Not being ready is not a bad thing. It's actually a motivating factor, because it's like, okay, wait, if I'm not ready, then what do I have to do in order to get there? And it motivates us, or I can't speak for us, but I could speak for me. It motivates me to get to a place of, let me get to a point where I can receive this. And like I told you, Laurie, the other day, back in October, actually, I was given about 170 pages of very, very high vibrational and important information. And I haven't read it yet. And I haven't read it because I don't feel that I'm ready to receive it. I'm not in the place right now with everything, with whatever I'm doing. I'm not in the place to read that and have it. I don't feel that I'm ready yet. And that's okay. You know, it's not putting you down. It's just, I think it's a part of the process. And just make it a little bit more exciting and fun for people, because it's not a bad thing.
Well, it's interesting because most people aren't in that. Most people do not want to. Okay, so a couple things came in as you were talking. One, the power of energy. A lot of us understand the power of energy, meaning the ways you can manipulate not only a mind, a human mind, not only physicality, but you can manipulate and you can do a lot when you understand energy, when you understand dimensions, when you understand consciousness. When you understand that, we don't even really, well, you and I may realize, other people here may realize, but a lot of humans don't realize the power that that holds when you have a third dimensional mind. Okay, so when you have a third dimensional mind and you are in a third dimensional consciousness, which means you have access to fear and greed and manipulation and murder and abuse, and then you put on top of that the ability to manipulate and understand energy in a way that a third dimensional human really shouldn't, yeah, it makes sense as to why we are having to take these baby steps to raise our own consciousness so that we pull ourselves out of these lower states of consciousness, fear, abuse, greed, manipulation, mind control, power, those types of things. As we start individually bringing ourselves into these higher awarenesses, higher states, when we start to understand energy and we start to access it, we won't access it from a level of awareness that a very dense third dimensional, you know, person would, let's say, right? So this is why it's happening so slowly. This is why we have to respect what's going on, because otherwise it's like what happened to Lemuria and Atlantis, right? Millions of years ago, it will literally bring us down and it will hold us back, which we don't realize. It will hold the human collective back. If we all of a sudden have this access to these energies that are not necessarily for the highest good of the entire collective right now, because the collective as an entire whole is still in a very low frequency. I mean, look at what we're seeing right now. Look at what's dismantling. Look outside your freaking door, turn the news on, and you'll see the frequency that we're still at, that we're pulling, right? So it's, and, you know, we have to have patience. We have to have patience. We have to respect consciousness and energy. You know, we were saying earlier that, you know, our bodies would short circuit on our bodies are energy, right? And they would short circuit. We would lose our minds and perhaps die. Literally, physically, our organs would shut down if we had too much energy within us. If we activated our 12-strand DNA right now, you would die. You would be like, I'm done. Like, we don't understand what that really means.
It's like saying, go run a 100-mile marathon without preparing. What's going to happen?
Yes, exactly.
You're going to end up in the hospital.
Okay. I mean when I was asking my guides to take me up on the craft, I was like, I'm so ready, like, look at my arms are out, I'm breathing really great, like everything's good, I am so ready to go up. And they're like, you're not even close. Like, on an energetic level, we have a lot of work to do with your body. And it was a massive bummer, because I was like, yeah, oh my god, this sucks.
It's like, oh,
I really want to go up. right? Yeah. The physical body has to be ready.
For sure. For sure. You know, when it comes to that also, yeah, I was just thinking if I wanted to share it, but I will. On February 6th of this year, for anybody that read the Pyramid Code, there was a meeting that I happened to be a part of that completely changed a lot of the way that I saw things, validated a lot of things for me. There was something that I'll share a short excerpt that happened over there to run through what you're saying, to really push it home from a personal experience that I had. There was something going on throughout the meeting, and I'm speaking vaguely on purpose because I can't share too much information. So bear with me. But there was something that happened throughout that meeting where there came a point where there was something going on that me and a few other people couldn't physically see. And we couldn't physically see it because it was out of our range of perception, because it passed the limitations of our level of awareness at the time. So one of the people in that room asked one of the other people leading that meeting, can you shift the level of awareness? Can you shift the dimension that Jason and the others are in so they could see what I'm seeing? I want them to see it. And his answer was something along the lines of, I could, but if I do, they're going to die. They're pretty much going to be electrocuted. And the reason for that is because me and the others in that meeting that weren't at that level of awareness, were not in resonance with that dimension where certain things were happening. If we were to instantaneously shift with the help of somebody else without preparing our bodies, without training ourselves to reach that higher level, that higher dimension where these things were happening, we would actually have died. So obviously he didn't do it, and that's why I'm still here. But it's a personal example of an experience of what you're saying, because that's exactly what it is. And that's why not being ready isn't a bad thing. It is frustrating sometimes. I'm not going to say I'm like, oh, you know, it's annoying. It's like, come on.
I mean, but I would love to be able to fly, right? Like, I would love to fly.
But what would happen if too much was given to you too soon, right? Look at the lottery. Look what happens with people. Anybody that wins the lottery that comes from an average to less than average place, for the most part, they lose the money within, I think, 2 years, the statistics say. And the reason for that is because the people were not ready to understand what that $100 million really means. So that's why I said certain things that I wouldn't even accept if it was given my way, because it could do more damage than good.
It just goes to show how cute we are as humans, because, you know, when you step out and kind of look at the human, you know, of course we want to be out of this density, right? We want to be out of the physicality more, and we want to have the fun tools, and we want to, like, you know, activate all these things inside of us. And we want to be in these higher states all the time. And we want to be able to see our guides and float up to the craft. Like, we want all that. Like, who wouldn't want that, right? Like, yeah. But we have to settle the more, this is again about attachment, right? If we can just drop into this journey that we're on, and that no matter what, right? Somebody asked in the questions, well, when is this going to happen in our lifetime? Well, you and I are both going to say, we don't know, right? Like, it would be awesome if it happens.
What's happening?
You say that again?
It's already happening. There are people that, I'm not on the collective global scale, but there are people that could.
That's true. That's true.
There are people in TLS that do that today.
You're right.
Certain things that they have to do. It's already happened. It's happened in the past. It's always existed, and it still exists. I think the question is saying, okay, well, what are we
going to... Yeah, like the normal Joe Schmoes.
I don't know. I don't know. I could tell you based on...
I think in this lifetime.
Well, honestly...
How long is this lifetime?
The only... That's also a good question, because people could live long. But I do think, first of all, it depends who you ask. If you were to go according to TLS, they'll tell you that by the year 2192, regardless of what happens, one second. By the year 2192, that's the deadline when we'll reach, regardless of anything. However, and this is a big however, because this is the reason why I'm doing what I'm doing today on a personal level. We don't have to wait that long to reach that new level of awareness, of love, that is once a month. Don't have to wait. And we could very, very, it's very feasible to be able to bring it to our life, but a lot of things are going to.
And here's the piece. Let's bring it back to our original topic, right? Because it is part of the original topic, which is, what block are you standing on? So this all encompasses the same thing, right? We just look at it in different lenses, like, oh, I want to activate my trail strands of DNA. Oh my God, I want to levitate. Oh my God, I want to see my guides. Oh my God, I want to go on craft. Oh my God, this, oh my God, that, right? You can't have one without the other. What do I mean? You can't stay in a scientific system, mm-hmm. right? In a third dimensional scientific system attached to your beliefs that's in a frequency that is lower than the frequency your body is taking you, which is going to allow you to see the craft and the this and the activations and all these things, right? So all of these layers of humanness have to break apart. They have to dissolve. They have to dismantle within us and in the collective. So it becomes this awareness of where am I at? What third dimensional first layer platform am I still on? Maybe the educational system, maybe the financial system, right? I'm still on probably the first layered platform of the financial system, right? Like, I still like to get paid for my work. And, you know, I'm not in this like free system where we're going to be going, right? Where everything is free and blah, 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 right? So what level are you at in all of these different avenues of your life without a judgment or an attachment to it? And when you think about truths and beliefs, when you're at a level one, right? Third dimensional platform, you are telling other people they're wrong. You're telling people that their beliefs are wrong. You're telling people, meaning you can hold the awareness that you don't believe them, right? I don't believe that truth. That's not my truth.
Okay.
Right? But to say to somebody you're wrong, to say to somebody that then you are literally keeping yourself in a third dimensional matrix. Totally fine, but can you be aware of that? As opposed to, you know, the person that came at you, right? It's like, okay, that's it. You were like, you held the, like, you were in a little bit of a higher awareness, right? You were like, dude, you got your truth and I have my truth, right? You didn't agree with his truth or his beliefs. You agreed with your truth and your beliefs, but you didn't tell him he was wrong. Never did you say to him, you're wrong, right? You were basically like, and he was in level one awareness. He was on the first step. You're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong. And the reason I bring this up is we have to start to observe what level are we on when we are leveling up, because you can't start to sort of experience all of these awesome things if you're also not aware of the way you're being with every human in every now moment.
For sure. It's polarity also, right? And wrong brings you into polarity. Polarity is a lower level of vibration, but it is not one. So I want to bring up another point. Whenever I don't know what your experience with this, but whenever I bring up the idea of we could live in a world without people and without war and without greed, all of that, there are many people that are very in alignment with it, but there are some people that say no, that's impossible, because all of those things that you said are a part of human nature. And personally, I don't agree with that. I don't agree with that because, no, energetically, that's not a part of human nature. That's just a part of our third dimensional reality that we're living in today. And when we tune out of that 3D mode into maybe a 5D mode or higher, those realities that I just said, the corruption, the greed, and the war, they don't exist on channel 5, in fifth dimensional awareness. So I just want to give my beliefs on it. I don't think those things are a part of human nature. although it may seem that way, because we think that our reality is human nature and the way things go on. I see it the way you see it, Laurie, energetically. Our reality is just what we're in resonance with, and we have the option and the right to shift out of resonance with that into a different resonance, into a different reality. And there are beings and there is life in the universe today that does live according to that level of awareness. There is extraterrestrial life that doesn't know what disease is. They don't know what war is. It's a foreign concept to them because they're in a different level of awareness. They're in a different level of consciousness. And therefore, the reality that they're in resonance with is a reflection of that consciousness. So it can do, I mean, the beauty of it is limitless. It's even their crafts, for example. We were talking about their crafts. Their crafts are pretty much an extension of their consciousness. What I mean by that is, and I'll share this also in the book that I'm writing and on a show that I'm doing on Gaia, more in depth. But when it comes to extraterrestrial technology, their crafts are not, don't work the way that we think that they work with this physical propulsion of movement. Their crafts work because they have a high level of awareness, meaning the reason why they can transcend the limitations of time and space through their flight, and they do, because the way they fly those things is not in correlation. It's not in alignment with the laws of physics as we know them today. The reason why they can do that in the first place without dying is because that craft is their consciousness to an extent. So to paint a little bit clearer picture, when you walk into one of those crafts, it's not like a 747 cockpit where you have a million different buttons with steering wheels and all that. It's more like there's this, and I'm what I'm sharing with you right now, I'm giving you from an experience of a very firsthand experience of the person who I'm very close with, who wrote the Pyramid Code, who's been in these crafts multiple times. The craft is not all these different buttons and all this, like you got to be a pilot to run it. That's not how it works. When you walk into these crafts, whether it's a pyramid, whether it's a triangle, whether it's a pill, whether it's a saucer, whatever shape it may be, the inside of the craft has something that looks like, it's like this dashboard panel of some sort that's made out of, I don't know what it's made out of, and neither does he, but let's call it crystal or quartz or glass or whatever it is, something along those lines.
Plasma light or something.
Something. I have no clue. But the way that it works,
you got to get closer. You got to come closer because then we lose you. Yeah.
There's physical technology and there's spiritual technology. So physical technology can be electromagnetic pulsation, electromagnetic laser pulsation, magnetic energy, energy from the sun. That's the physical aspect of it, of the technology. Spiritual technology, on the other hand, is something that's referred to as the power of thought. Okay, so the ability to do things through thought, to move things through thought, to connect to this unified field of consciousness through thought, because that's what we are. That's what this whole thing is. This panel that they're operating this craft with, picture it, there's a high vibrational extraterrestrial being. Putting their hand on this panel. The panel, from my understanding, acts as the link between the spiritual technology, the power of thought, and the physical technology, the EMP, EMLP, and all that. That, whatever that thing is made of, however it works, is the link, is the connection. What it does is through the power of thought, it suddenly, the craft, becomes an extension of the consciousness of the operator. That means that if the operator has a consciousness that transcends the limitations of time and space, that craft will transcend the limitations of time and space. That means that whatever is in resonance with your consciousness or the consciousness of the operator is exactly how that craft will be able to behave. And the reason why, it all connects, by the way, to the whole idea of what's alive and what isn't. Well, alive is not constituted by a beating heart. Alive is constituted by consciousness. And the craft is just as alive as the operator. And the reason why they can make that craft an extension of their consciousness is because something that they understand, not just conceptually, but in application and experience, is the absolute fundamental reality that that craft is a part of them in the field, in the unified field of consciousness. That's where you see those crafts moving on. It's unbelievable.
So when I was writing my book, everything that we are in right now, the body, the earth, the stars, the moon, the trees, whatever you want, everything physical was created by intention and energy. And when they were giving me this, I was like, what the fudge? How do you create a physical body from intention and energy? And it's exactly like, it's a little bit more complicated when you talk about the physical body, right? But it's exactly like what you said. They took high frequency light, okay, because they knew how to manipulate energy. Again, you have to know how energy works.
Exactly.
And they use their body, right, their energetic body, to intend, which you would say is thought, right? But it's an intention. And this, by the way, this is how you become from source, right? You split from source as a consciousness or a light, and you then begin to intend through awareness and energy who and what you want to be and experience. It's all through intention, which is what do I want, right? But it's not even an I when you're in a, when you're outside of the human body or even outside of like physicality. It really isn't an I, right? Yeah. But it's about energy and then your intention. And so we are all, this human experience at least is the moon, the stars, all of this is an extension of the consciousness that created us based on the intention that the earth had. But it's all, it was their intention using energy and light, spinning it down into a lower frequency in order to create physicality, which is what happens with craft. The reason we can see certain craft physically is because they bring it into that dimensional field. They bring they intend that energy to slow down to a state where we can physically see it, and then they intend or thought and energy back out.
Yeah, and by the way, that's the connection, and they're highly connected between the spiritual world or the spirit world and the material world. I can't say we, but from my experience, I've seen a lot of people make the spirit world isolated or separate from the material world. And they're not, they're one and the same. They may seem different because they look different, because they behave in different parts of, like, it's like the spirit world is in this part of the water bottle and the material world is in this part of the water bottle, but it's part of the same bottle. And therefore they're one and the same, they just behave differently. So again, we're speaking about this, it's a concept at this point. But in order to not just become aware of something, awareness is the first step. In order to truly be something and be what we're saying, it starts with that level of awareness of, okay, right? Like we said earlier, in order to fly, you first have to know that you have wings. So I think that's the phase that's the part of like the waking up process on the collective level that it seems to me like we're at, where everybody's suddenly becoming aware of, oh my God, we actually have a lot more power than we thought. And oh my God, this may not be what I thought that it was. And it's actually this. And it is just a beautiful process to see.
Well, you think about where the levels of awareness that we have the ability to access eventually. You think about the building blocks. I mean, okay, here's a vision I'm seeing right now, right? You walk into a playroom and there's like a huge pile of building blocks or like, you know, those wooden building blocks that you would play with as a little kid. They're all these different sizes. I'm talking like a heaping mound of them, right? And this is all of our ability. This is all like the difference. That's the quantum field, let's call it, right? So there's all these, like, there's so much magic when we walk into this room, and there's so many things that we can play with and explore and tap into and blah, 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 right? But we have to be the human first, right? So you have to peel away you have to literally take all of those building blocks to find that one little building block at the very bottom of the pile, right? And that's where we're starting.
Yeah. That's where we're starting. And we have, a lot of us have this awareness of what we're in, but we still have to take the tiny baby steps of like, oh, here's my next level of awareness. Oh, here's my next level of awareness. Boom, 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 boom. And eventually you step out and you're like, oh my God, you mean this entire time I've been that little building block underneath all of this,
Like, it's crazy. Somebody asked, as you were saying that, which is really interesting that they brought it up because it's connected. They said, question, what about the holographic universe? And the reason why I think it's so important in regards to what we're talking about is because it also gives another foundational concept of how to eventually incorporate this into our state of being instead of just state of understanding. So what is the holographic universe? The question I would ask is the world around us, does it exist in isolation of us? Or does it exist because of us? And when we go deep enough, it all boils down to awareness. Because the only reason life can exist is not because of water. The reason life can exist is because the ability to be aware to any capacity, whether it's a capacity that we can understand or not. So awareness is what creates all of this in the first place. So really what we're seeing is, let's take a snake, for example. I think they have thermal vision, if I'm not mistaken. A snake, if they were to look at a tree, would see a tree completely different than we would see a tree. So if human beings no longer existed, and I'm asking you to think philosophically now, if, or theoretically, I don't know what to call it, if human beings didn't, if there were only human beings, snakes, and trees on Earth, and the human experience completely disappeared, there was no human beings in this form anymore, and there were only snakes, then does a tree, through the perception of a human being, exist anymore? If there's nothing to perceive it, it's a weird concept to grasp or to think, but if there's no human to be aware through the vision that we have of what a tree looks like, then the only reality that exists, which is pretty much awareness that exists, is the awareness of that snake, which means that a tree really looks like a thermal tree rather than what a tree looks like to us. So what I'm trying to get down to is everything that we're seeing is not actually what it is. It's that energetic fundamental reality that you're talking about. And what is really going on the quantum and fundamental level of everything is everything is energy. This bottle, this glass bottle, doesn't actually exist. I perceive it in this form because of the resonance that I'm in. But fundamentally, this form does not exist, because if I could slow down the vibration of this bottle, I would be able to push my hand through it. The only reason that I can't is because it's vibrating pretty slow. But
very slow.
Very slow. Oh, so if I said it the opposite. If I was able to increase this, then I would be able to pass through it. So
yeah.
The what I'm trying to say here is reality as we perceive it is not the fundamental reality. It's an illusion, as weird as it sounds, that this TV is a TV. They're illusions, and it's a manipulation of energy that we experience and form. But the reason why we see anything is because we have eyes that transmute energy or light into form. We have ears and eardrums that transmute energy and vibrations into sound. So without us, and that's the idea of, if there's no awareness, does reality really exist? And I can't say whether something's right or wrong, but I can give you my belief. My belief is that awareness is what makes reality possible in the first place. And with that understanding, the idea of a holographic universe is just that. It's that everything is here because of awareness, and our ability to perceive is what makes the universe what it is. So what it really means is we are the creators. Our awareness is the creator.
I mean, listen, if somebody were to ask me about the holographic universe, I'd be like, first of all, I don't even know what the freak that means. It's like, right. One, right? Like, I don't know what you mean, holographic universe. And how is it going to help me in my everyday, right? Like, you can go out into this, like, massive, like, philosophical sort of explanation of it all. But you're absolutely right. First of all, it's all an illusion. It's all energy. It's all consciousness, mm-hmm. right? It's all consciousness. And it is all, it is, like we said, it's intention and energy that's moved down into a physicality. And mm-hmm. so because we're physical, this is what the reality is that we're in. This is what we're seeing. Oh, look at the game we're playing. Okay, this is the movie that we're in. For me, what's more important is, how do I navigate? If I'm in a holographic universe, right? Mm-hmm. I don't care. How do I navigate my nows based mm-hmm. on that awareness? How does that benefit me? And what can I do with the fact that this is all an illusion? And for me, the reason I love to see everything as this sort of movie mm-hmm. set that I'm on is because it allows me to not get caught up in it, i.e., if all of a sudden I'm watching a system being dismantled, right? We call it whatever system you want. Mm-hmm. I'm not attached to it. I'm watching it happen because I know that it is all an illusion. So you talk about, you know, you throw out these really philosophical questions and it's all great, but can you actually tangibly do something with it in your now moment? Or are you just having a philosophical conversation and then coming back into your third dimensional ego and saying, fuck you on the screen to people and making these bad comments to people? You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. that's all great if you're going to ask that, but how are you living in your now moment with that awareness?
That's the biggest question there is, okay, you could talk shit all you want, talk high all you want, but what does it actually mean? How do you apply it? The reason why I think things like that are important is because, again, first comes the awareness of a topic. As you're prepared to understand what that topic actually holds, and we all do that at our own pace, certain things can become activated of a higher vibration. Why? Because as of now, for the most part, anything that we speak about in, the, let's say, extraterrestrials that have a higher level of awareness, if we try to speak about 5D, we're going to end up speaking philosophically to an extent. We're going to end up speaking theoretically to an extent, because at this point, it's just a concept.
Right.
On the collective level, it's a concept. Why? Because the concept brings the awareness. So first comes the idea, okay.
Right.
Death is an illusion.
You're right.
Great. Now what? If death actually exists, what the hell? Or take time. I'll show you a perfect way of applying it. In my first book, I wrote about how time is an illusion and why it's an illusion. And it's completely a conceptual, philosophical understanding of how I can begin to explain what's going on to my understanding. So as I'm doing it, I ask the same question. Wait. Okay, why? Somebody asked me. I don't give a shit. Is an illusion. Why do I care if time is an illusion? I'm living here. I'm living now. Today's today. Tomorrow's tomorrow. And I'm going to die. And it's all good. Mm-hmm. And I think, well, wait. When you truly come to understand that time is an illusion, if you don't understand that first conceptually, we can't reach that level of awareness where you can fly a craft that transcends the limitations of time and space.
Yeah, you have to understand. Yeah, you're right. You're 1,000% right.
It's important because it sounds like what is this high shit you're talking about?
Yeah. I was being devil's advocate. Sure. And I actually did believe, but there is a piece to that. But you're absolutely right in the sense that we have to open that booklet. We have to say, oh yeah, look at this, look at the large, you know, field that we're in. This, you know, Oh, your sound just got really funky. Time, now it's better. Time is an interesting one because it's one of those concepts that for me is really challenging to dissect, because the best way that I just dissect time, I did this when I was writing my book because I had to I had to figure this shit out in my book. So they said it's like a record player. Okay, so think of a record player, and the way time works is if you're speeding up a record player, the song is going to start to go faster and faster and faster and faster and faster. All of a sudden, you won't even have a song anymore. It'll just have like a tone, right?
And that's how time is. When you speed up energy, eventually it just becomes the now, right? And when you slow energy down or you slow the record down, all of a sudden you start to hear the sounds, you start to hear the words, you start to hear everything. And then when you slow it down even more, the song starts to become freaking forever. A 3-minute song is now a 2-hour song. Mm-hmm. Based on how low or how slow you're spinning that record. So the lower in vibration you go, the slower things become and the longer it takes to get through things. Does that make sense?
Yes.
That's my analogy.
Okay. No, so I get
that. That's all I got.
What I got from the time thing was the idea of the present moment. Because again, talk about it. There's the book, The Power of Now. It's great. It's coming into us, but it's coming into us in a way where, I'll give you a personal example. When I first started reading about the idea or the concept that time is an illusion, I understood this much. And it's an infinite concept. So there isn't how much can you act? Is there a limit to understanding? But it came to a point where, like, as time went by, as I became more ready, and that's why readiness is important, to understand a certain concept, time suddenly became this, it's like, oh my God, wait. So if time doesn't mean, thank you. If time doesn't mean, if time is an illusion, then are there really past lives or are they parallel lives? And if that's true, then can you live at the same time energetically in multiple different forms? And if that's true, then do you ever really die? Because there is no concept of you if your energy isn't, it just keeps going and going and going. And I'm sure in maybe a month or two, I'm going to get something out of it of like, what the hell, you know, and it keeps going. But first and foremost, like you said, the awareness comes. And sometimes when we don't understand something fully, it first has to come through thought, like you and I do a lot when we have our FaceTimes. It's like, well, let's think about this. If this, then this. And if that, then that. And we keep going through that, and suddenly certain things become active, and they become more and more and more active. And we realize more and more and more about a specific topic until that information doesn't just become a knowingness or information, but it becomes our beingness. And I think that's what we need to transcend to that other level of awareness. It's not enough to know something conceptually. Somehow we have to shift from this knowingness where it starts to the beingness of where it actually exists. And that's what I'm trying to figure out, because I mean, that's what we need.
Well, that's what we're learning and that's what we're doing. I mean, that is the beingness is the hardest. And I say hardest, I don't mean hardest, but it is a challenging part of this awakening process, this ascension process, or this evolution in consciousness that we're doing, because it's, you have to be it. You have to, which is energy, right? So you have to learn. We are relearning or remembering so many amazing aspects of beingness that are beyond physical, that are beyond the physical reality. And, you know, time is one of those. I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm sure a lot of people are starting to recognize we're spinning the record faster. And what does that mean? Time is really effing weird right now. Like, time's going by faster than ever. Time, there's glitches, right? So all of a sudden it's like time will just stop. And then you'll notice that like 3 days went by and you're like, wait a second, what happened to those 3 days, right? Like, There's also what's happening is people are quantum shifting into other now lifetimes. So what people are starting to do is they will tap into, so every lifetime that you may have had on this, let's just only talk about this planetary body. However many lifetimes you've had as the consciousness that you are in this in different physical bodies, they're all in the now moment. So they're all now. And so when you start raising your awareness and you raise your consciousness, what you're capable of doing is being able to, like, it's like, I kind of call it like a glitch, like something glitches. And all of a sudden you're like, I just tapped into a previous now version of me that wasn't a previous now. Yeah, it's a now, right? And or you'll go into it. Here's something that's really cool that's happening to people. They'll tap into a future, either a future now, which is a now of them now, mm-hmm. right? Or another lifetime now. And then let's just say it's a future, bear with me. It's this same lifetime, but it's a future now that's happening now, right? They yes. somehow, there's a glitch that happens in their awareness. They all of a sudden see that version of them. It's almost as if it's in the now. The now becomes that future now. They move back into this now, and then they eventually get to that now, and they have a deja vu. I've been here before. I've seen this before.
Weird.
Right? Because they, but these are things that are happening now because we are raising our awareness, we're raising our consciousness, and we're like, what is going on with all of these different levels of whatever that is?
Yeah. You know, if you look at time for what it actually is, we all know it's relative. It's just relative. Just like you said, I sat down in a meeting once that was 12 hours. And because of the context of what was going on, I didn't even know I had no idea that 12 hours passed. On the other hand, I sat in a classroom for 1 hour and I wanted to kill myself because that's what the teacher was saying. So it's time is really relative to your perception of what you're experiencing at that time, which is very important. But if you look at it really, if you just run through it logically and forget about the fact that the whole time is relative thing. Let's say you're in California, I'm in New York. Right now by me, it's 1:27 p.m., 1:30 p.m. By you, it's what, 10:30? Okay. We're talking at the same time. We're talking right now. But by you, it's 10:30 a.m. By me, it's 1:30 p.m. The time is irrelevant because we know we're talking at the same exact time. So, okay. Let's say that there was like a train track connecting New York and California. When I'm in New York and I'm about to get onto this train, New York is in my present moment and California is in my future. When I get on the train and I'm somewhere in Wisconsin or wherever it is in the middle of America, in Texas somewhere.
Wisconsin.
When I'm in the middle of the train track, relative to where I am on the track, New York is in my past, California is in my future. But we know everything's happening at the same time. When I get to California, California suddenly becomes my present, and New York is in my past. So now, let's say we zoomed out completely, and we were no longer on the train track, but we left Earth and we saw the train track from space. Well, if I'm watching you on the train, you may think that New York is in your past, and LA is in your, and California is in your future, but I'm looking at you from outside of Earth and I'm seeing this whole point from point A to point B, and all of that exists at the same exact time. So that railroad track that I'm referring to is what many people might refer to as the Matrix. And when you're in the Matrix, we're actually, the way I see it is we're kind of hardwired to have a fixed perception at a fixed point. And the moment when what allowed me to realize that was when I was in the subway once in New York City, and I tried looking at one point in space while the subway was moving. Okay. And what I realized was my eyes kept going like this. I couldn't physically look at one space without moving my eyes while there was something moving. And the reason for that is because we're literally, our hardware wants to focus on one point instead of the no point, the everything that we're made physically. So I think that's what our consciousness is also kind of like built on in this level of awareness, where we're built right now in the resonance that we're in to focus on one point, to focus on where are we now. And it really fits with the reality that we exist in of duality. There's past, present, future. There's right and wrong. There's good and bad. It's all part of this thing that isn't the idea and true experience of oneness. So just circle it all back, that's why I think the illusion of time is so important. Because when you talk about it theoretically, it's like, what the hell am I getting out of this? But when you really think about what's going on, it can bring us to this understanding. It's brought me to an understanding of, okay, I'm still a human. I live in this reality. I experience life. I got to go to meetings. I have a birthday. I got to make the train. Time becomes a measurement to be able to live in modern day society, but it's not a reality. And therefore, for me, certain fears kind of dissolve when I came to that understanding, because I'm like, I'm not going to die. You know, there is no death. I'm just experiencing this, but there's another experience somewhere else that's always going on. It's just this liberation.
Well, check this out. Go ahead, keep going.
No, that's it. It's just I feel liberated from that experience.
That's the bingo piece. So when you start recognizing that time is an illusion based on our frequency. So when we are in a lower frequency, we will experience time. However, we are also in the quantum space, which means that there is no time. There is a now moment, and only a now moment, and every now moment is just that now moment.
Yeah.
Now we have to play in the illusion of time, because we have dentist appointments and we have yoga classes and we have children to take care of and we have jobs, right? So we do have to play in the illusion of time. But every now moment that you're playing in the illusion of time, you have the ability to be present in that quantum field of no time. The reason that this is so powerful and so important to practice, because I don't care if you have dentist appointments and all of these things, you can still practice not being in time when you're in that illusionary time space continuum.
Yeah.
When you are able to practice now moment states, you take away all preparation for any now moment that may or may not happen, because you have no control over what may or may not happen. Because everything is shifting so quickly right now from a frequency standpoint based on timelines. The railroad is a timeline, right?
Yes.
And because we are shifting collectively and individually so quickly, shifting meaning the frequency, the energy within your body and within the collective's body, the trains are shifting. What does that mean? Well, that train used to go to New York and now it's going to Connecticut. And then it's going to go up to Maine, and then it's going to go up to Canada, right? So you may think that you're going to New York and you may have this, like, let's talk about vaccines. Oh my God, there's a mandated vaccine. There's a mandated vaccine. That means we're going to New York, right? If you're out of the now moment and you're thinking, holy shit, we're going to New York, and you're actually on a train that's going to Connecticut, you're wasting a lot of energy preparing for a New York bound train that's actually going to Connecticut. Which brings us to, what is the timeline? Let's talk about Connecticut being the higher timeline, right? What train are you on? Not what train is everyone telling you that you're on, right?
Yes.
But what train are you on? And when you stay in the present moment, that's all that matters. In the present moment, your fears dissolve because you don't know where you're going to end up. You can hold the higher timeline, but even that's going to shift, right? And that's the power of it all.
And in addition to everything you just said, all timelines exist right here, right now.
Yep.
And the liberating factor that I feel is I can choose which one I want.
Like you're at the New York, what's this train station in New York?
Penn Station.
Yeah, or Grand Central Station or something.
That's where it is. It's like, well, if time doesn't exist, suddenly I become free to choose which client I want to live, experience. And all of them exist right here, right now, but which one do I want? And you're no longer confined to the one that you're experiencing. You're limitless to what you can choose and what options you have. That's it's like, you see, now we're talking about this what started as a philosophy, and through that conversation we're like, okay, well, this actually means this, and it means this, and it means this, and
yeah. Because the other thing is like, okay, so there's a train going to New York, right? Mandated vaccines.
Yeah.
There's a train going here, oh my God, civil war. There's a train going here, oh my God, we're gonna be in internment camps, right? So there's all these like trains, right, that have these like possible doomsdays. Then there's trains of like, oh my God, I'm going to the new earth, oh my God, I'm going to 5D, oh my God, I'm going to love and compassion and empathy, and like all of these, like, you know, unity consciousness. There's all these trains, right? And they're all real, and they're all in the now moment.
I always teach that. I'm like, that's a real timeline. All of those.
But why do you think somebody would choose a train that doesn't serve them?
It's a great question.
You know, it's like, on one hand, you tell me this is, I don't know, I have to think of an example. But why choose something that scares you over something that's like...
I don't, but a lot of humanity does. But
why do you think people do it?
I think they do. I think they choose like a New York timeline because they don't understand sovereignty yet. And they don't they don't understand that they are in control of their reality because we have been programmed and controlled by the systems, by the little choo-choo guy who's in charge, whatever that guy's name is. What's that guy's name that runs the train? The choo-choo man?
Conductor.
Yeah, the conductor.
Okay.
He is telling you where your train's going. You don't realize, right, that, or not the conductor. Let's say like when you walk into Penn Station, the guy, there's a person on the intercom that's like, this is the day, today is the day, and this is where you're going. This is the train you have to take, blah, 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 right? So you're told what you need to do, the train you need to take, blah, blah, blah. And so you're programmed to be like, oh, I guess I have to go on this train, even though there's 70 other trains I get to choose from. We're programmed.
Yeah, first of all, I completely agree with you. What I'm getting from that now is they're not choosing.
Correct.
Question was, why would somebody choose the one that doesn't serve them? And from what I just got from you, which I completely agree, they don't think that they have the freedom of choice. So they're not choosing in the first place. Ah.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay.
And then let's go even further. Okay. Yeah. I love these. These are good analogies. Let's say you're on the train. Let's say you got on the train to New York and you're going to New York, and New York is the mandated vaccine. I'm only bringing this up not to bring us down into this lower state, but it's what's happening, right? So we're on the train going to New York, mandated vaccine. Let's say that it actually unravels in your town, right? So now you're on the train and the last stop is the mandated vaccine, and holy shit, now you're there and now it's happening. You still have choice.
Mm-hmm.
You still have choice. You still have the choice of how you're going when you step out of that train, right? And you're in line or whatever it is that you're going to be experiencing. You may not necessarily have the choice that you had, you know, 3 months ago, which again, everybody, which is why it's so freaking important to choose your timeline, right? Because as a collective, we can shift the railroad train. But anyway, aside from that, let's say you get off the track, you're in New York, you're getting the mandated vaccine. How are you going to choose at that point to experience that now moment that you're having, right? You have an option of how you're going to experience it.
So, okay, I have a question. What do you, it's pretty much dictated by the collective at the end of the day in terms of what, I mean, no, I think we do have our individual experiences as well, but what if the collective decides to go and choose a timeline that we happen to be a part of that we don't want?
That's the ripping the Band-Aid off real slow.
You know, because there are a lot of things where you, I mean, if you live in the world, you live in society, certain laws can be passed. We have no choice. And yes, those laws were kind of imposed upon us in the first place because we, as in the collective, chose a specific timeline. But there are some of us, many of us, that don't want that timeline. And it's like, what do we do? We do exactly what we're doing right now. We speak about it and we share it and we try and bring that knowledge and shed light on the power to choose. Ultimately, I think Dr. Pilevsky said it really, really well when I spoke to him. It's not that they have everybody's like, our civil rights have been taken away. And I mean, you're not wrong. I completely agree with you. But it's not that our rights and our power have been taken away. It's that we collectively gave it away. And you know, I think I'm just kind of running through my head. I think part of my intention and the intention of all of this is really to bring awareness to the fact that first and foremost, this is our responsibility. We have to take responsibility for what's going on here. And everything that we're seeing in our world is a reflection of us collectively. And it's not, you can't just want to be an individual when you live in a world of everybody, because the individual I is all of us. It's not an individual you to your body and your actions. It's our actions. So it's like picture humanity as one human body. There might be some cells that are multiplying rapidly and causing cancer. And there are other cells that are, no, that's not going to happen. We're going to stop that from happening. That's how I kind of see the world today. It's we're one big organism. We're this one unit. If one cell in the body is like, no, I don't like that guy. I'm just not going to do it. I mean, that body's going to die because the cell didn't. It's not enough for the cell to just feel a certain way about itself individually. The cell has to do something in the body because we're one unit. So I think, and it feels like that's part of what can be done to acknowledge the fact that we are one unit, whether we like it or not. And everything that we see is a reflection of ourselves. And we had a conversation about this the other day. I think to make a change, yes, we focus on the collective, but first and foremost, we focus on ourselves, because we individually as that single cell, if the single cell is not healthy, it starts interacting with other cells, it will damage the other cells. But if the single cell first works on itself, goes to the gym, gets strong mentally, and it's like, I can do this, then it starts coming in contact with other cells, and the other cells are like, look at that guy. I could do that.
I want what he has.
Doing it. And then eventually that cancer stands no chance, because it's just in one part of the body where all these cells come together and take it over.
Right. That's definitely so true.
Yeah, I think it's a part of what can be done, not just on the level of you and I doing these live shows, but everybody. You know, everybody has a significant role in the world. And the analogy that I always give to explain that one is, if there's like a puzzle and each piece of the puzzle is a different size, whether we're talking about a piece that's this big or a piece that's this big, the puzzle will never be complete without all of those pieces. So whether your impact is on your significant other, on your children, on your students if you're a teacher, on your patients if you're a doctor, on your clients if you're a lawyer, I don't know. No matter what it is, we all hold a certain piece of the puzzle, and the size of the piece is irrelevant. It's just, we each have to do our part, and we have to do our part through first taking responsibility for what's going on here. I think that's the only way to make a change.
And, you know, I couldn't agree more. I'm skipping all over my words, or what's it called? Mumbling my words. When we start taking responsibility for how we are choosing to be, I deeply believe that this whole entire human collective will shift a lot faster.
For sure.
The only way to start choosing is to start becoming the observer.
For sure.
You can't choose if you don't observe.
100%. I think we should make take initiative to very openly set that intention also in the next meditation that we're doing on 12/12, to instead of banding together to fight others, because that's not what's going to help us, we band together to heal ourselves individually. I think that will bring that new age that we're talking about a whole lot faster, because suddenly we become the powerful being. Everybody we come in contact to is impacted by that energetically, whether it's subconscious or conscious, they're impacted by that. So I would definitely take, and Damien, by the way, a friend of mine that Lori knows, Damien brought that up to me as well. And he said, listen, focus on make sure that you guide everybody that's being that is choosing to be a part of this meditation. Guide them in a way where they don't come into vibration of resistance of what we see in the world, but acceptance of what we see in the world, and a feeling and a vibration of self-responsibility for themselves, not to fix others, but for themselves. Because if you do that, everything is connected, it'll shift.
Right, which is basically sovereignty, which is I am only responsible. Now, please don't say, well, what if you have kids? I'm not talking about that kind of I'm only responsible. What I mean is that in a sovereign field, you are safe, you are contained, and you are an energetic being. And nobody is doing anything to you. You're not a victim.
Okay.
You're not unsafe. And you are free. And you are making choices in every now moment. There's no such thing as somebody's energy coming into your field unless you consciously or unconsciously allow it to enter into your field. You are not turning on media and saying, well, they're telling me this, so I have to believe it. As a sovereign being, you choose. Am I going to believe this, right? So when you start stepping into sovereignty more and more, you are taking action, you are making choices, you are safe, you are free, you are looking out and you are saying, from this space, from this energetic frequency that I'm holding, first of all, what is that? What is my frequency that I'm holding? Is my heart open? Am I holding compassion and empathy and love, right? And instead of battling or combating that which we don't like, we focus on our sovereignty and this frequency of safety, this frequency of choice, this frequency of love, this frequency of compassion. And that has a ripple effect that is 20,000 billion times more powerful than screw you, you suck, I hate this, I don't like this, I don't want this, I don't like that, we've got to destroy that, we've got to take that down, right? Yep. When you come back to that sovereign space, it's like, okay, well, what am I going to choose to play in? What's the frequency I'm holding? And what am I emanating out from my body? Which is why love, compassion, and empathy is so huge. But you're right. Starts with choice.
For sure. The resistance is the same low vibrational realities that we're experiencing today, only with a different thing. So definitely it's like if you want to be healthy, and these are choosing timelines, right? Let's say you're currently experiencing the timeline where you're sick. I don't know. And you want to be healthy. Are you going to say, I don't want to be sick? Or are you going to say, I want to be healthy, or I am healthy? The choice comes through your words, your thoughts. If the power of thought can operate a craft traveling at millions of miles per hour, the power of choice can also is strong, effective enough to choose which timeline you want to experience. So when it comes to words, what you focus on is what you manifest. The subject that you're focusing on, your sentence or your thoughts. If I say I don't want to be sick, it's great that your intention doesn't want to be sick, but your words are resonating because they are frequencies and realities. Your words are literally resonating on the frequency of sickness because that's what you spoke. And that's a reflection of what you thought. So when you get rid of the sick part and you start focusing on the healthy timeline, then you shift. Because what the hell are you? It's like you're on the train to New York and you keep saying, I don't want to be on this train.
I hate this train.
Tell me what train you want to be on. You know,
yeah.
Train you want to be on, not the train that you don't. So, yeah.
And you know what? It's even if you think about the way that the higher dimensional beings work, they don't work with words. They don't create with words.
Yeah.
They create with energy, which for us in this lower dimension, energy would be more of like a feeling, right? Yes. So if you go past the I am healthy kind of mantras, right, which never really resonated with me. Mantras never really resonated with me. I get it. I completely get it. But I have to feel it on an energetic level. What does healthy feel like to me? What does that other train feel like to me? What does it feel like to be in a world where there aren't mandated vaccines, right, for COVID? Like when I tap into the feeling of that next version of me or that next timeline, that is when my energy becomes it, right? So it's way more, it's so much beyond. Now, granted, if you're saying words like, I don't want to be blah, 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 you're like, you might as well just stop. Like, you're not, nothing's happening, right? It's energy.
My words, whether somebody else or myself, act an indicator, like a measurement to see where I'm at on the physical level. Then there's the feeling of, no, I could feel this, you know? But for me, my, whenever I'm feeling something and I can clearly see why it's happening the way it's happening because of how I'm thinking, I focus on not, I don't focus so much on my words because mantras aren't something that works too much for me. I don't resonate with them too much because it's just like, I could write this all I want. I'm not feeling it. For me, it's more so, I truly believe, and maybe that's why it works, that certain foods based on their color can help activate certain parts of the body based on what frequency or resonance you're trying to activate, based on what you're trying to shift. Because color is frequency, and it's like a very, it's just like a tool in front of your, in front of me that's very apparent to, like, you know, I think it all comes down to your belief systems. Because if people, if somebody truly feels that mantras help them, then mantras help them.
For sure, 1,000%.
Feels that whatever helps them, then that thing helps them. So yeah. That is the strongest part of it. It's what do you truly undoubtedly believe?
Right. Like, you could believe, this is for real, you could believe that eating grapes is how you're going to manifest the next partner in your life. And if you believe that, how you're going to...
It brings that energy.
Yeah, like, it doesn't matter what your belief in it, your intention around it is all that matters. So,
sure.
You know, you're absolutely right. Like, so we're all going to have our unique ways of sort of, you know, navigating this and figuring this out. But if you realize, though, from the quantum field that it's just energy, then pay attention on an energetic level to how you are feeling around that which you are creating. That's all. If you are saying, I don't want this, then you are in a resistive state. Feel it. I don't want to be heavy. I don't want to be sick. Feel that. That is a resistance and a restriction to what you are in the now. If you say, I am healthy, I am, and these things work for you, it's because you're bringing yourself into a different frequency. Oh my God, this feels amazing, mm-hmm. right? There's all these different ways of doing it. But
I personally use three things. Use my intention, my belief, my visualization. Visualization is a big part for me, because if I can see it, if I can't see it, then I know that I have doubts. If I could see it, then it's just, I called you the other day, you know what we spoke about.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Happening.
Thinking about that. Yeah, I was like, I wasn't going to bring it up, but I was thinking about it. You know, what's interesting as we're talking is that I always hear my guides, right? And I'm always seeing this from the perspective of my guides. And they're like, oh, you guys are, you're so cute because you're just trying to figure out this whole manifestation thing when it's really just a now moment. Eventually you'll realize that it's just a now moment, right? Like, we're trying all these like tools and techniques, right? To like figure this out and how to do this. And they're like, eventually it'll just be a now moment. You won't have to figure anything out. Because I'm thinking about people that have illnesses and dis-ease and cancer and things like that in their body. And there will be another now moment where we will heal it instantaneously. But those illnesses and diseases are the hardest to sort of heal, because the belief systems around healing illness is so complicated. It's so complex. We have a really hard time sort of believing that we can heal ourselves instantaneously or even over a couple of months, which we can, right? We all know that we can. But that belief system, the beliefs will eradicate any energetic healing that may happen. The belief, the thought will cancel it out.
Yeah, and think about it. If you fly a craft with it across the universe, you can heal your body with it. It's there, you know? And for whoever is like, what do you mean the power of thought? I could speak to you and change your mind about something through thought. I could think about something, or forget about that. Let's take a really obvious one. How do you think you move your hand? You move your hand, you can move your legs because there's a thought saying, I want to move my hand. And you're moving this thing that, what the hell is it? Again, back to the whole hand thing. But the fact that we do anything, it starts as a thought. The question for me is, where did the thought exist before you thought of it? And that's what brought me to the reality of every timeline exists. but it's a whole, I'm sure it's a conversation that can go on for a long time of where it exists and what to do with it and all that. So I call that place, by the way, the reason why my first book is called Forming the Formless is because I call the place of where do your thoughts exist before you thought of them. I call them the formless realm, because if your thought is energy and energy cannot be created or destroyed, then it existed. It just didn't exist in the form that it did when you thought of it. So somehow, somewhere, everything exists. The question is where, how, and what can you do in order to guide and manipulate, in a bad way, but guide and manipulate that energy to self-serve you in a life that you want to live. That's it.
It's interesting because I'm they're showing me this like future now moment that's going to be coming for a lot of humanity, and how this conversation is going to be really, really important and really challenging, meaning we may be faced with things that we don't want to put in our bodies. Mm-hmm. Okay. And if you understand that your light is more potent and powerful than any chemical, what if that's true? Which it is true. Okay. And you step outside of you step outside of chemistry, you step outside of physics. I mean, physics in the sense of like putting these two concoctions together and it creates this, and then this creates this in the body, and that system, that first of all, it's layer one boxed third dimension. It's true. Mm-hmm. It's not the only truth. If you understand your light, and this is part of why there may be things that we have to inject into our bodies for some people, because we have to start to understand the power that we have as light beings. What if our light within our bodies can actually dissipate or dissolve any harmful attributes that we have been taught and have created massive amounts of disease and all kinds of other stuff? Well, I say what if because I'm just throwing it out there, but I absolutely 1,000% believe if you can fly a craft with intention and energy, why can't you dismantle any sort of thing that comes into your body that is foreign?
You could. The question is, like I told you this last time also, I'm going to get to that point one day. But it's one thing to conceptualize what you just said, and if you believe it, that's amazing. But those are some like high vibrational thoughts. You got to be somewhere of.
Okay, well, here's the question to you.
I'm in.
I know you're in, but you're not 100% in. So what holds you back?
I'm in.
I want that ticket. I mean, what holds us back to saying, oh no, Lori, you're nuts. Because the only reason that we would be faced with a situation where all of a sudden we're having to receive something inside of our bodies that we are not necessarily okay with, let's just say that plans out. And now it's like, okay, now become this higher dimensional consciousness. Now become the light. Now change your reality. Now do it in a very different way than choosing a timeline and intending, you know, some sort of situation in your life. You didn't have a choice of, okay, am I going to believe third dimensional science or am I going to believe higher dimensional energy and light?
How do you do what you're saying with still living in this world?
You choose. You choose to not believe what they have told you this whole time, even though it's true.
Yeah, but I'm trying to figure this out because there's got to be a way or some sort of guidance.
You step out of it.
Yeah, but there's some people that step out of it that do more harm than good.
You have to believe it.
Like, how do you, let's take vaccines for example. People look at others that don't take vaccines. The majority of people that think in this sort of way as a danger to society. Okay, so how does one that doesn't want the vaccine, that believes that I'm not taking this. It's not my truth. How do they respectfully confront or reply to a human being that truthfully, in their truth, thinks that they're a danger to society? Because at that point, it's not enough of, and I've had conversations with this. So I'm telling you from my own experience, they don't give a shit what your truth is. They think you're harming human beings if you don't want that. There's a clear, you are a danger to society. Your thoughts are dangerous. They should be censored. And you got to shut up. That's what I've been confronted with.
Right. You handle it just the way you handle it, which is, I'm a sovereign being. I don't care how you live your life. I don't care what, go do you. Like, go do you. Go do you. Why do I care what? So you can speak your truth. You can educate from a sovereign space, which is, if you understand sovereignty, you're your own bubble. Okay. And you get to speak and scream and protest in your bubble.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about forcing your bubble and hitting like a bumper car somebody else's bubble to knock them over, give them a WWF smackdown so they wake up and see your bubble and go, oh my God, I should have been doing it the way your bubble's doing it, right? Like, you're learning how to live in your bubble, walking around with 4.7 other billion bubbles,
yep,
holding your truth while they have their truth. And you're like, thank God, that's not my truth. Thank God I don't live in that fear, right? And they come at you and they're like, no, you're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong. You stay in your bubble of sovereignty and truth, doing whatever you need to do, yell, speak, you know, protest, I don't know, whatever you want to do in your bubble. But when you are in the bubble of sovereignty, it's not about trying to convince somebody else that their sovereignty is wrong. How can you possibly do that? That's saying their frequency is wrong.
You know what? You're 100% right. And I'm saying that because that's what happened to me yesterday. That's what, by the way, sorry to interrupt. I have to go in a few minutes, but we'll finish it all up. That's what happened to me yesterday, where about that person that you were saying that posted of, again, listen, it's his truth. He thinks I'm a danger to society, that I'm killing people, that I'm bringing misinformation that can do a lot of harm. And he truthfully thinks, and I get it from his point of view, he thinks, according to what he knows and he learns, and he went to medical school to learn, and spent a lot of money and a lot of time in isolation studying this information, he thinks that somebody like me, spreading the information and speaking about the things that I'm speaking about, is a danger to society and his eyes. And again, and if I put myself in his shoes where he's at, I have to stop because I can hurt the world. So I guess, I mean, the way I handled it was exactly what I just told you. I told him, I said, listen, I don't agree with you. I respect you completely. I understand where you're coming from. And I get it. And then, you know, the whole trying to start a fight, let's debate, let's talk, trying to like provoke and instigate the situation. I didn't let that happen. I said, listen, I've been through this dance many times. I respect you completely. I got you. All good. I'd rather not go through this whole thing. So let's not do that if you can respect it. And let's just move forward. And I respect you, even though I don't agree with you. And I hope you can do the same. And we move on, you know? So the only sticky point is when it comes to legal purposes, it becomes a little...
Right.
I mean, you should deal, or you could deal with it the same way, but there's a whole other kind of set of obstacles that... Because, I mean, it gets to be a problem. So I guess right now... Yeah, I would answer the way I answer. I would still ask that question and then maybe get back to it. But
just, I mean, I thought it, you were totally like, I mean, how you handled it was amazing. It was so amazing.
It's difficult, you know, because like internally, because I'm not a perfect being of light that's like this high vibration or whatever. Internally, I'm like, oh, but then I'm like, stop.
Yeah.
Not going to react. You're going to respond. You're not just going to trigger back. You're going to think about the situation. You put yourself in his shoes. You're going to think about why he's doing what he's doing. And then you're going to respond. And that was also liberating, because it was like, it's like, whoa, okay. I'm not thinking, I'm not acting impulsively, because I, in my past, for anybody that knows me, I tended to act very impulsively. And I guess through those experiences and through those times, I'm like, no, just chill out. Let's think about what you do before you do it. Let's think about what you say before you say it. And it's liberating. And not always will you get that. Not always. It's not about winning or losing. Not always will you get the. You're not always going to. It's not about changing the person's mind. You know, you're not going to get there always. And if you do, that's great. But from my experience, at least, if you do react for, if you do respond out of a situation, out of a place of that compassion and love, or at least try to, what is the person really going to say back? You know, then they're just fighting themselves, which is okay if that's their choice. But yeah, I would say from my experience, and I'm kind of answering my own question through thinking about it with you, it's think about what you say before you say it. Put yourself in the person's shoes to be able to try and understand how you would receive what you're saying if you were hearing it, whether you agree with them or not. And then answer in a way, or respond in a way, where they will have nothing to say back.
Or they will, and they'll just want to keep going, and you'll just say...
Against you. They could say, but never put fuel to that fire of, well, what about this? No, because again, when it comes to proof, if a person doesn't want to believe something, you could bring the most definitive proof there is, and they will have something to say about it. So forget about all trying to prove your point. Let it go. You share what your truth is. You share what you think is correct. And do it freely. Forget about who's going to listen to you, who's going to unfollow you. But I could tell you one thing. If there's one thing that I saw over the past, and I'm still learning a lot, over the past 3 months.
3 months?
Yeah, seriously.
I know. It's so cute, though. It's like you're just beginning. You're like...
When it comes to Instagram, that's when it started, the whole thing. But the whole, a lot of people I see are in like fear of, oh my God, if I post this, like my following isn't going to like it and they might unfollow me. And it's like, dude, you do what you think is right. You do what your truth is. And I'll tell you one thing, there will be people that unfollow you, but there's also going to be others that decide to follow you that are more in alignment with your resonance. And it's not even about the people that choose to listen or not to listen. It's the fact of, as cliche as it gets, your vibe attracts your tribe. Don't try to fake something because you want to fit in. Be yourself, and you'll fit into the community that you actually belong to. And I went through that on a personal level, because I had multiple years throughout my life where I just decided to be somebody else because I didn't want to be me, because I thought people would think I was weird. And today, people think I'm weird. But guess what? I'm weird. You know, I'm not normal. I'm weird. I'm a weirdo. And I freaking love it. Because that's what makes me different. That's what makes me unique. So share what you want to share. Do what you want to do. Forget about the fact that people might not like what you're saying because it crushes their belief system. And you push your belief system for yourself. I think that's how we're going to make a shift here.
It's definitely something I'm practicing. I mean, I've talked to you about this myself, you know, as a teacher, as a spiritual teacher. It's definitely something that I am, a fine line that I'm walking and learning how to navigate, because it's not easy out there right now with the, this is what we're all learning. I think this is a huge piece of what we're all learning, is what you just said. Which is so amazing. Also, if you think about it, like being you, speaking your truth, like how can that, why is that so challenging?
It's so much fun. It's like, laugh it off. You know, people think you're weird. When people think I'm weird, I really laugh because it's funny. It's not like these things aren't serious. It's okay. So somebody's weird. Somebody looks at you like, what the hell is wrong with you? Some of my family does it to me. I sit at dinner table with them. it's all good. And when you respond in a way of like laughter and fun, you're throwing those vibrations into the equation. What are they going to get mad at you?
Right.
You're laughing. It's funny. It's all good.
You know? Well, you think about it really quickly. I know you have to go. If you think about your family coming at you, right? Like your dad or your mom or your sister, your brother, or whoever, like, I can't believe you think this. I can't believe this. Right. There's this energy, this frequency of like, bah, right. And if you respond in a completely different frequency, it literally dissolves it. They have nothing to go on. It's like, wait, what happened? Like that guy that came at you, right? He wanted you to come back at him in that same frequency. As soon as you come back in a different frequency, there's nothing to grab. He has nothing to grab any longer. Yeah. It's like, wait. No, you're supposed to come back at me and this same frequency. And then we yell and argue at each other.
That's what I mean by don't give them anything. Don't give them resonance. We're responsible for shifting the resonance on our side of the equation. If we do that, they will follow. And then collectively, we can choose a new timeline.
A new train track, a new train.
Maybe we'll go to Bora Bora this out of New York.
I'd like to go to, I'd love to go to Bora Bora. That would be awesome.
I'm dying. You're powerful.
Bora Bora?
Yeah, there's a huge vortex over there. Unlike the center of the island with the mountain thing.
Yeah. I've seen that. I've seen a photo of it. We did it. 11:11.
Oh, wow. Wow.
What time is it for you?
2:11.
2:11.
Yeah.
Well.
All righty. I enjoyed this, by the way. I enjoyed the fact that it just kind of like, just flow, you know?
Someone's in Bora Bora right now.
No way. They said it?
Yeah. They're like, I'm in Bora Bora. I don't know if they're lying or if they're just like pretending to be in Bora Bora, but they said, I'm in Bora Bora.
We'll go with it. It sounds fun.
It sounds fun. I loved our conversation as well.
Yeah,
there's going to be more of these, right?
Oh.
I mean, not now.
Say it. Go wait. I'll leave that part. There's going to be beautiful things for everybody that's listening.
Yeah, our meditation on 12:12 is happening.
Yes. 12:12 at start at 11:45, like usual, 15 minutes before. Meditation.
Eastern time.
At New York time.
From
12 to 12:12, we're going to go for 12 minutes. And yeah, this time, let's really try to set the intention in terms of the guidance of taking that self-responsibility. It's not about fighting others that we feel are imposing upon us. It's about shifting ourselves in order to shift everything else. That's where I think we should focus the intention, because it's important.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
I love it.
Alrighty.
Okay. I love you so much.
That was my love you.
That's your love you. And thank you everyone that stayed with us and that's going to watch us on the replay. We love you.
Yes.
And we'll see you guys next time.
All righty. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Bye.
Bye.
I'll save this also for everyone.